Hello, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to Marche with Marche. My name is Marche, and of course, I came on here because I have something to say, something to talk about. And so, my conversations or my real life sparks conversations, sparks my thoughts. And of course, I'm listening to Dear Future Wifey podcast all day. So, of course, that causes me to want to have more conversations and all types of podcasts, the Shay Shay Show, and everything that I watch, like on YouTube, right? While I'm working. But, my whole point that I came on here for, partially, don't care if I look like Celie from The Color Purple, my hair just, you know, being thick and coarse as it is, and my edges not being perfect, like, you know, how everybody's edges nowadays has to be laid and suede, and I like that look. I'm not gonna fake on them and be like, oh, everybody's doing too much with their edges looking like this. No, I mean, some of it can be extreme, but for the most part, I like those looks. I never said, oh, that's too much. No, I like that look. I just don't have that look right now, okay? So this is the real me, is what y'all gonna get. Oh, and look at my chin. Pimple in the middle of my chin and everything. But this is what you're gonna get, right? So, the reason I came on here was because it was several things. But one thing was, when you're not raised by your parents, I don't know if people realize this, but it's hard for you to feel safe, to trust. It's hard for you to open up. It's hard for you to be vulnerable. So when I get online, sometimes I'm like vulnerable with my thoughts and my feelings to, you know, just a video, just a camera, because I feel like, well, I'm just talking out loud to myself. I'm not really talking to anyone specific. But it's hard for you to be vulnerable. It's hard for you to open up emotionally. It's hard for you to trust people. It's hard for you to it's hard for you to even feel safe or have those communicational conversation with even your own parents or other people. And reason being is because of things that you've watched, things that you've seen, things that you've experienced with them, either, you know, not being as present as possible, or with them not being the key factors, the ones in the household to raise you every day, take care of you, etc. So me as a child, when I think about my childhood, I think about how many times I felt like I raised myself, me and my cousin both. I'm not going to speak for her story or tell her story for her. I'll allow her to do that. But what I will say is, you know, just from me and those experiences, feeling like a child who I was able to make a lot of decisions that I, things that I wanted to do without thought of asking a parent first. I never had to go to a parent to say, can I go this place? Can I do this? I never had to consult a parent for anything. Not only that, I never had a parent who said, well, this is what I want you to do. This is how I want you, like, who gave me a guideline kind of in life. I had my, I don't want to specifically go into details, but I'll give a brief. Like, I had a father who every now and again, he would give me like certain things that, you know, I feel were tidbits that I still carry with me to this day, like thoughts, life, you know, his opinion, his thoughts, his feelings, whatever. They're embedded in me somewhat, parts of it. And then like my mother, things I've seen around me, that I experienced, blah, blah, blah. But my whole thing with that is, you know, you don't open up, you don't trust, you don't feel safe. And me, I automatically developed a quietness. Even my mother spoke on this herself. She had to be honest and say, you know, like, she realized as I got older that I shut down from her. I wouldn't talk as much to her. I wouldn't open up. She would ask me stuff or talk to me, and I wouldn't be answering. I wouldn't be responding with as much energy, or I wouldn't be feeding into the conversation. Why? Because I had shut down my heart or my feelings or my emotions from her, because I felt untrustworthy. I felt unsafe with her. And not saying because she physically harmed me or anything of that sort of nature, but because you didn't protect me by being there for me. So I don't think parents realize this. When you're not present in your child's life consistently, not just present every now and again, not just present here, there, and everywhere, they can have sprinkles of you throughout their lives, but when you're not present, consistent, there every day, there every as often as you can be, then they will feel not protected by you. Because when something happens, who do you supposed to go to or look to? Your parents. And when your parents aren't there for you to go to, then who do you go to? The other guardians that you're in the care of, or the people that you may be there with. But guess what? Everybody doesn't feel safe going to those people. They may be great people, they may be good people, they may be loving people, but they're not your parents. And that's why I come on here and I make the videos and I say what I say, because I want people to understand the importance of that role of parenting. I want you to understand the importance of being a mother, the importance of being a father. Me, people may say I take being a mother too serious, some people, but the reason being is because of my life, and because I want my son to know I'm his safe place. Like this post said on Instagram, I'm the place you come to when you're hurting, when you're happy, when you're full, when you're hungry, when you're in need, when you don't need, when you want, when you don't want. Why? Because I want you to always feel like you can come to me. If nowhere else, if nobody else, if there's nothing else, if there is everybody else and everything else and anybody else, I want you to still say, I value my mother's opinion. I value my mother's thought. I love my mother. My mother loves me. One thing I know is my mother has always been there, whether I was right, wrong, or indifferent. And that doesn't mean I agree with his behavior and go along with anything or lie and scheme and cover up for him. But what that means is I'm there. I'm still there no matter what. Good, bad, or indifferent, I'm there encouraging him to do better. I'm there supporting him, teaching him, guiding him, leading him. I never felt like I was guided or led by anyone. I feel like, yes, I had my grandmother's there to, you know, make sure I ate and had a place to stay. I wasn't living on the streets homeless or anything of that sort of nature, but I still felt unprotected, devalued. Like, who do I go to when things are wrong? Who do I go to when I like something and I want to participate or I want to do this? Who am I going to? I don't have that one person who I run to ask for everything. I don't have that one person who I go to say, well, this is what's going on with me, or can we just talk about this? I don't have that person. I don't feel safe with people. And I don't trust people because my parents, yes, they were there in my life, but, you know, it just wasn't a normal mother and father parenting relationship where these are the people you call for everything, every day. Mom, I'm hungry. Mom, can I take your food out the refrigerator? Mom, can I eat your french fries? Like, I don't have that, you know, not even french fries, because that may be whatever, but I don't have that relationship. I don't have that, Mom, can I wear your shirt tomorrow? Father, can I borrow $15? I'm going to the movies tomorrow with my friend. Or I don't have that relationship with my parents to that degree. I have a relationship with my parents. Yes, I do. Very much in my life, people will see them, Instagram, the whole nine. And I think people will misinterpret things and say, well, you know, they look like they're there. They look like they're present. You're in pictures with them. You're in videos with them, which is wonderful, which is great. But I don't have the relationship with them. If you read my books, you really took the time to get to know me, to really speak to me, to really have any history on who I am, to understand who I am today. Because people look at me and they're like, you're just so quiet. You're just so shy. You're withdrawn, or you're not interacting, or you're not doing this, or you just seem so mature, so old. And yeah, old soul is often mistaken for a person who had to be present for themselves when no one else was, who had to show up for themselves and others when nobody else did. And sometimes it'll look like, oh, you're so mature for your age, but sometimes you want to be young, live, and have fun, but you don't know how to. And sometimes, and me, I'm cool with being who I am because I'm a mother now. So it's like my responsibility is him. And these children don't ask to be here. They didn't say, hey, it's my time now. It's like, I mean, partially they did. But really, it's like, no, you chose to go out, be grown, open your legs, do whatever. So this is your work. And, you know, children need you. They need to feel like this is my guide. This is my love. Even fathers. I was thinking about this yesterday. I don't care what people think, but yesterday I was thinking about this. Even in my home, I was just like, it's so important. Oh, that video on Instagram sparked this. I was watching a video on Instagram, and the guy was talking to his son. He said, you've been a blessing to me your whole life. Those words right there could make me cry right now. Like that, the breakdown, oh my gosh. Like, the son was quiet the whole video, but imagine a child saying that to you. Imagine a child saying that to you. I mean, not a child. I'm not even saying a child. I'm sorry. I didn't mean to say a child saying that to you. Imagine a parent saying that to you, that you have been a blessing to me my whole life. Children are so used to, I don't know about your community. I can only speak for mine and my things that I've seen. But in the Black community, oftentimes, a lot of the times, seeing families who feel like, you know, the child is a burden to them, who feel like, yeah, I had you. I love you. I care about you. I want to make sure you're safe and fed and all of that, but you're in the way, where they often feel like, you know, if you weren't right here, I could do this, or you're taking up time and energy and space and resources when I could have been doing other things. So they don't look at you as like you're an addition or a blessing to their life past when they're pregnant. Like when they're pregnant, it's like, oh my God, you're going to have a new addition and your blessing and this and that. And then when they have you, sometimes they're overwhelmed by life, which I understand. They don't have the resources. So, you know, they may not have the finances to be able to do everything that they want to. Time is not on their side because they have to work, and they have to maybe sometimes work two jobs or go to school and work, or they are trying to, you know, fulfill their lives at the same time as build a life for you. And so they become overwhelmed by their circumstances. And so with people being overwhelmed by their circumstances, sometimes they're stressed out. They say the wrong things. They're like, I don't have time for you. I don't have time for this, or that's in the way, or be quiet, or go sit down, or do this. And they don't see how you add to their lives. They don't see the blessing that you are in their life. And when this father looked at his son and gave him the car, and it's not about the car. I know everybody else, you know, superficial people are going to look at the video and say, oh my gosh. Superficial people are going to look at the video and say, oh my gosh, he gave his son a Dodge Charger. He's graduated from high school, I believe, and da 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 da. And oh my God, that's so amazing. Superficial people are going to look at that and be like, oh yeah, and that color and that and this. I wish I got that when I was that age. But a real deep down, good God-hearted person is going to see, oh my gosh, this man just poured into his son beyond the car. The blessing of being able to tell his son how important, how valuable he is, how much he loves him, how much he cares about him. And to hear that from a father, yes, you need that. You need that from your father, just like you need that from your mother. You need to know that you're important to them. You need to know that you matter to them. You need to know that you are valuable to them. And when you don't know that, you'll seek validation in other areas, whether it's in the way you dress. You want everybody to think you fly. Now, nothing wrong with being fly if that's who you are. But what I'm saying is some people do it and they can't never go outside and have a bad day because they feel like, oh, everybody's going to look at me and see me as like this, and I'm not going to be who they think I am. See, me, people think internet, Instagram, Facebook, pictures, me being cute, me and my son doing photo shoots is who I am. No, we love to be beautiful. Well, I can't speak for him, but I think he does because he always say cute because I kind of told him that. But, you know, like, I love to be beautiful, get dressed, go places, do things. He loves to get dressed, look nice, go places, whatever. We do this, but guess what? We take our pictures. Yes, that's us. That's part of us. But I also am this, looking regular old boring t-shirt, regular old boring pants, regular old hair looking crazy, need to be done immediately. Trust me, I'm not liking this. I'm not liking at all, but it's the circumstances. And I'm just like, you know, people don't understand how important you are. Parents, you matter. Fathers, you matter. It's not just, oh, you ejaculate in a woman, now you're done. No, there is work to be done. And I'm sorry, oh, you don't like this woman, you can't stand her. That's on you. You shouldn't be sticking your stuff in nobody that you don't like. If you can't stand them that much, but you like, oh, but I wanted to have sex with her. Well, you should have made sure you tried every resource of protection. And if you did and you still had a child, well, guess what? God said, I'm going to bless you anyway. And if you don't take the blessing for what it is and add to that child's life or her life or people's lives in general, guess what? That stuff come back to you. People think doing people dirty.
Turn right on Brinkley Road.
People think dogging people out is like, oh, it's cool. Nothing's wrong with that. It's fine. Everything will be okay. No, it won't. Don't do that. No, it won't. No, it won't. Like, people need to stop lying to people. It's okay. Yes, God forgives, but God also believes in what goes around comes back around. He may not say it like that, but I don't know the specific scripture that reads the words like that, but what you reap, you will sow. Boom. That's it right there. What you reap, you will sow. So whether it's good, bad, or indifferent, if you sowing bad things, you're going to reap bad things. If you're sowing good things, you're going to reap good things. And sometimes it don't seem like it, because I told y'all even in the video before where I feel like the life I imagined for myself and the life that I'm living is not lining up. And it's like, hold on, I believe in God. I love God. I trust God. Why is this my life? But guess what? It's still going to come. That's one thing I believe. It's still going to come. And I'm just saying this to say, too, though, a lot of people think that, you know, oh, they could live life and care about superficial things, hair and clothes and this and that. No, it's about your kid heart. And when you show off, you feel good and the world loves you and everybody's impressed by who you are, but then your kid hates you. That's what a lot of rich parents, you know, the stories that they tell in movies and shows where, you know, the child lived the best life because they had everything they wanted, everything they needed. But then the child didn't have their parent's heart because the parent was too busy working or too busy. And it may not always be that they're doing something bad or horrendous. They may be genuinely doing something decent. You know, working is not bad. It's just the fact of if you do it excessively, knowing you have a child who also needs your love, attention, and affection and quality time, that's when it becomes bad. It's not essentially a bad thing until it becomes too much. And that's anything we overindulge in can become too much. Even water. You know, people may think, oh, water is so great for you. It is. But guess what? Drink too much of it and you can get sick. And so, and that don't mean don't go drink no water, because most of y'all not drinking enough of it. But my whole point of saying this again to say, you know, and if y'all see my stuff back there, I'll let y'all know what that's for later. But my whole point about saying this is, you know, it's important to understand that people come from a place, and however you see them show up in the world is because of the place that they came from. It's because of the things they've experienced, the things they've done, and whether they go the great way with it or the opposite. is life. And I just want people to know, you know, it's difficult for people to trust people they don't have a relationship with. And if you don't know how to keep some things to yourself, me, I'm like almost a gatekeeper. It's a lot of things that people have told me, people have done, people have shown me that I know that I can't even speak on because I'm like a gatekeeper. I know so much information about so many things and so many people that who have come around me or I've experienced. But it's like I'm a gatekeeper because I can't repeat those things. I can't say those things. And why? Because I'm an honorable person. If you tell me, don't mention this, don't say this, don't do this, then I'm not going to. But part of me may feel like, wow, like if only this person knew this or only this person really felt this or knew this about this person. But I'm like, it's not my place. So what I often pray is I know something, I don't like it, and I feel like, well, even if I know something, say I may not agree with it, maybe I told that person, whatever, they do what they do, they look grown, they can do what they want to do. I pray to God, I'm like, whatever's in the dark comes to the light, because God always reveals. I don't know about you, but I know about me. Like, I'm the type of person, God reveals so much to me. Not everything. I know y'all might be like, well, then how you do this if God reveals everything? I mean, I ain't say everything. I'm human just like you. I mess up just like you. But when I say God reveals so many things to me, God does. He reveals a lot of things to me. And when God reveals things to me, I have to open up my eyes and see them for what they are. And I have to realize, oh, wow. Oh, God. This is what you're doing, God. This is what you said that for. This is why that happened. Oh, gosh. No wonder. Now I understand. Now I see. God is going to show up. And when I say God is going to show up, he shows out. God is going to show up and show out. And God is going to do that for the people that are doing that for him, who are believing in him, loving him, trusting him. Sometimes I look at it and I'm like, God, hi, I'm the believer. But this look like this. Or this is this. Not even what it looked like. Because what it looked like may be different from what it is. God, how am I the believer, but this is this? You know, even the woman that prophesied over me, I believed her word wholeheartedly. Because when she said it, it just felt like it came from God. I knew it was nobody else saying that but God. And she said, elevation, elevation, elevation. She said, all I see around you, Marche. She said, yeah, and it's another book you got to write. And it's going to bless women. Now I'm starting to think about what that book is. At first, I was like in my head when she said that. I'm like, I don't feel like I'm in the women ministry. I'm a woman. Yes, I am. But I'm like, I don't know. I've always connected more with men. And I know that may be like, I don't know. Some people look at that bad. Like, why can't you connect with women? I just told y'all my history. Y'all don't understand. But like, I don't always connect with women. So sometimes I connect with men more. And when she told me that, in my head, I was like, I believe her. Because she said, God says, keep writing. You know, there's something another story that you have to tell or whatever. And I'm like, hold up, what story do I have to tell? Because I can't even really think of nothing at the time that, you know, was like pivotal or important or special enough for me to write about. And then I was sitting there thinking, I'm like, hold on, women, me? Like, I could see something maybe with children because I love children. I connect with children. They love me. So I'm like, okay, that makes more sense. Maybe children, maybe even, I don't know if I can speak to men because, you know, I'm not a man. But now I'm starting to get it. I'm like, oh, no wonder. God kind of made me go through that so that, you know, I could tell that story to women. Now I see. And I'm just basically saying, you know, because I'm almost somewhere, so I want y'all to be all the way in my business. But basically, yeah, stay true to who you are. God's word is not going to come back void. That prophecy is going to come to pass. Y'all going to see elevation, elevation, elevation. It's going to come. It's going to happen. And you're going to be surprised just like I am, okay? So make sure you like, comment, and subscribe. This is Marche with Marche. And as always, I'll be back.